Chapter 5, Temporary to Permanent Shelters. A temporary shelter is one that protects human life, animals, plants, or materials from the elements while a better, more stable, sound structure is being built. The temporary or transitional shelter can be a very efficient area for planning and development of the site. A sort of workshop with sleeping areas, if need be, and eating areas. If preferred, a separate shelter for eating, preserving, or preparing foods. A small geodesic dome, RV, trailer, barn, metal storage, or a simple log structure can be easy to construct and demand less time and energy. Renting an existing nearby house during construction is also a good option. The structure will become the focus point from which the site will begin to manifest itself. It also can serve as a prefabrication site as well as material storage. Each day must be devoted to playful yet serious work. The greenhouse gardening projects should be started as soon as possible. First, for food replenishment and, of course, to establish an edible landscape. On most undeveloped sites, if still fertile with the organic process already at work, lucky you. Take the time to check out the existing plant growth. For instance, in my area we have hickory trees, muscadine vines, blackberries, elderberries, walnut trees, and blueberries, poke salad, and many other herbs and others that are native and come up naturally. Try not to destroy food-producing native plants. If these should be growing already where the temporary shelter is to be built, water and fertilize the ground around the plants or transplant them into the desired areas and fertilize and enhance growth and yield. Using mulch and animal manures called composting and mulching. Compost bins are to be constructed out of rocks and logs or dirt and lumber. These should be located some distance from the structure, usually at the edges or centers of garden sites. RV with solar electric module system. Once the temporary shelter is in place and the other more permanent animal and human shelters can begin as materials, time, and ability is acquired. Most streams supply a portion of sand, clay, gravel, water and rock, and hopefully fish. Some even have pottery clay or a potential power to do work from a small hydroelectric plant or just a water wheel. Decay, rot, and rust is usually at work on a site, enhancing to speed up the process of decomposition. Adding more already decomposing materials like fallen trees, leaves, and or animal waste. Encourage earthworms and microbes that speed up the decaying process. In time, plant rapid growing coverage that will thrive on the decayed material, bringing it into the living plant organism and re-releasing its matter to the environment, into a new birth and atmosphere. The land is reclaimed. The natural process of enviro-sheltering can begin and new processes started, as well importation of vegetation onto the site. Streams also need to be tested for water purity. Start by hiking to the head of your stream to see if any discharge or runoff may be entering at some point upstream. Note the washes on hillsides that enter the stream. If a potential problem is occurring, begin at once to set in motion the energy for correction, for water is a vital resource, as we all know. Mountain Hillside Solar Hydro Power Plant. A well also is an option for a site, and the rope, pulley, and bucket will bring the water to you onto a windmill or photovoltaic pumping system installed. First, the well has to be dug or drilled. Hydroelectric generator is dependent on the flow of water through the site or heavy rainfall in the guttering system. The amount of water falling is measured in gallons per minute or running pounds of pressure. This amount will vary greatly from different sites. There will be variation from the dry to wet weather seasons. We can illustrate the varied electrical supply in amperage with the average use pattern of a region's wet season, which is usually the spring or fall time of the year. Water falling with a running pressure of 40 pounds will yield a steady 24-hour electrical charge to a battery bank at around 10 amps. The extra water can be used for a storage cistern or irrigation or other domestic purposes such as a fountain or a waterfall. The electricity can also be used to operate DC well pumps directly or other fun water projects. Water well, soil levels, and bedrock. The site for a well is usually chosen in an area where it is close to the shelter or possibly below the floor of the future well house shelter chosen by a dowser. This way the pumps and pipes will be protected from freezing. The method of digging the well, of course, would depend on the equipment available to you. Hopefully, in the near future, biodiesel or solar-powered well drilling rigs will be commonplace. Wind-powered electrical system. Most wind chargers will begin charging batteries with a 8 mph breeze, or a wind machine can also pump water directly. Wind power comes in many variations, such as wind speed, direction, temperature, height, gusty, or smooth. This, of course, changes with the seasons, making wind energy hard to predict, but mostly is blowing during seasonal changes. Some wind sites have a prevailing wind that is fairly constant year-round. Airflow is less turbulent and more steady 5 feet above the tree lines. Also, a good power tower can be used to mount photovoltaic modules, water tanks, solar collectors, and communication devices, etc. Biodiesel pumping station. Methane, natural gas, biogas, or wood gas powered motor driven alternator is a unique way to disperse organic waste. 20 pounds of dry matter, which consists of dry leaves, vegetable scraps, straw, and activated sludge, will yield 250 cubic feet of biological gas. This gas can be used to run engines, cook, light, refrigerate, boil water, etc. The gas produced when sludge is piped underground to a storage digester for on-demand fuel use when needed. Personal use patterns illustrate the consumption rate per hour with various burn tasks. A 1-horsepower combustion engine will consume 18 cubic feet biological gas per hour, coupled with a 2,000 watt DC 110 volt generator. The generator will produce 1,860 watts while running on biological gas. The generator set on automatic demand during high human use pattern periods. Generator peak demand backup with human use patterns for all seasons. As well, a natural gas converter system on the average car will allow this system to refuel hybrid automobiles at the local household station. Solar powered irrigation and livestock watering station. Of course, now. Okay, our water system needs a means of pressurization. So here again, we have chosen to use a simple solar energy design to accomplish this means. A solar-powered pumping station is basically a 12-volt or 24-volt direct current pump that uses direct sunlight to activate the pumping cycle. The water is raised into a tank that is elevated above all other domestic water systems as to advantage the extra pressure by using gravity to push the water to outlet water systems, either hot or cold, either day or night, all around the habitat. Many solar farmsteads will have local utility water available at a meter, and this is the option to tap into even though you may not want to drink the water or pay a water bill. anyway, to invest in your own water system will be cheaper than bottled water or utility water over the long haul with less waste. Portable solar shower. The next subject to be considered is the shower area or bath. A shower house or stall can be constructed very quickly on the site and should allow for adequate hygiene and clothes washing as well drying. All these chores can be accomplished using solar hot water collectors in a super insulated storage tank located several feet above the shower head or using a photovoltaic pump. If a well or water supply isn't easily available, then a rainwater cistern can be incorporated into the system to collect strained rainwater. Since rainwater is falling from the sky already above the habitat, there is no need to use extra energy to pump it around, so we suggest to collect the rainwater at the highest elevation, possibly usually a few inches below the roof gutters or inside the attic. The cistern can be plumbed into toilets, exterior wash and cleaning basins, irrigation, and other domestic water destinations. Once we have accumulated our dependable water supply, we can begin to get creative with some really nice water projects, such as a solar heated hot tub, solar fountains, waterfalls, garden streams, small pools, ponds, and swimming pools, etc. Solar shower design. A modern, very efficient washing machine can be operated off a photovoltaic array NAAC inverter. If you are using an old-fashioned clothesline, both should be working well in full sunshine. I'm not just advocating you do washing clothes just on sunny days. Hot and cold water is one of the most important aspects of the modern world, not only for hygiene but for many household uses, and is expected as common in these times. So we have begun our system with the quest for water. The units we have chosen to use are thermal siphon systems because not only are they the simplest to construct but uses the least amount of energy to create hot water. The basic rule that hot water rises is used within these systems to activate the heater only when the sun source is there to circulate without pumps and heats without any electricity or gas or other sources. Convection moves heated liquid upwards in the system and is simultaneously replaced by cooler liquid returning by gravity. Ideally, the liquid flows easily because a good thermal siphon should have very little hydraulic resistance. To keep the water hot during nights and cloudy days, the tank is super insulated inside the attic area. For freeze protection of the collectors themselves, they can be located inside the attic space under a large south-facing skylight. Thermal siphon solar hot water collector system. The storage tank located above the collector receives heated water coming from the top of the collector into the top of the storage tank. Colder water from the bottom of the storage tank will be drawn into the lower entry of the solar collector to replace the heated water that was thermal siphoned upwards. The storage tank may or may not use a heat exchanger. The thermosiphon system is more costly and complex than the batch system. In our area, it is best to use an indirect system, one that employs a heat exchanger. In this case, antifreeze can be used in the system, eliminating freeze-ups. This type system, located in an attic area and super insulated, can save hot water for most cloudy days with some input from a wood heater hot water coil system. Solar clothes dryer. Even rainy days are good for washing. Using a simple water wheel and filtered rainwater to do the chore. In fact, clothes can be hung up in a special closet in the upper portion of a shelter with a drain pan as its floor. The warm air rising from the shelter vented into this closet will simply drip dry your clothes on rainy days. Clean clothes are a must, and people all over the world have become accustomed to the concept of a machine to wash and dry their clothes, and expect this technology to continue into the future. Okay, a traditional clothesline has been in use since time immemorial, and this basic concept of hanging clothes out in the sunshine is still a very efficient, cheap way to dry clothes. But is there still a better way? Let's explore some possibilities of the total solar-powered laundry. Here we have done some experimenting with a solar chamber that acts as a clothes cleaning closet. When exchanging clothes, simply hang the used pair into the solar closet and activate the cycle. Once the clothes are scoured with solar-heated hot water through pressure nozzles, the clothes will drip dry towards the floor grate. Drain, and solar preheated air is circulated through the chamber, or in some designs a skylight is installed. Futuristic fabrics can be designed to accent this type of solar cleaning. You will find below some links to some interesting innovations we have found that look very promising technologies or easily incorporated into the solar electric laundry systems of the future. Solar hot water shower stall. Another option, rather than using a modern water closet, is to install a composting toilet. These devices are very efficient at decomposing human waste without using water, and in some cases without electricity. These also eliminate the need for expensive septic tanks and field lines. We will now discuss several of these methods and introduce you to composting toilet world. Composting toilet world is an advocate for the use of composting toilets worldwide. Our goal is to educate, promote, and facilitate the use of compost toilets. Well now that we have all our basic creature comforts intact, let's move on to the next discussion. Sleeping, eating, and entertaining study areas are very important places for not only for the human being, but also for the human spirit. In today's world, most people are used to their electronics and are surrounded by them. I'm talking music, pods, sales, players, DVD players, televisions, telephones, computers, as well other personals such as flashlights, electronic game players, electric shavers, coffee makers, blenders, can openers, refrigerators, microwave ovens, water and heat pumps, and of course light fixtures and fans, as well almost any modern appliance and electronic item can be powered by natural energy systems. Thermal-controlled PV-powered attic vent. All these devices have one thing in common. They use electricity. Most actually use very little electricity. But some appliances use more, such as the refrigerator and heat pump, as we will talk about these separate from the others. A super-insulated thick-walled chamber is a very efficient refrigerator and freezer designed for solar electric applications is used in most areas. Refrigeration has been around for quite a while now, from its humble beginnings of a simple ice box to now giant walk-in coolers, freezers, and HVAC systems. Many prototype solar-powered heat pumps are making headway in the markets all around the world. Solar distiller. A fresh water supply is a concern for all humans, as more contaminants are finding their way into the rivers, streams, and aquifers. A simple solar distiller device can easily provide gallons of fresh water for drinking and cooking. These units can be designed to be plumbed into a south-facing kitchen area, or simply incorporated on the south-facing roof and gravity-fed anywhere into the habitat below. Energy from the sun heats water inside the steel to a point of evaporation. Water vapor rises, condenses on the inner glass surface of the steel, and drips into a collection tank. This process removes impurities such as salts and heavy metals, as well as eliminates microbiological organisms. What we are concerned with here basically is food preservation and human comfort. So let's start with a well-insulated passive solar living space with an old-fashioned pantry for storage of dry goods, seeds, seasonings, herbs, and canned goods and the like. Store as much of your food stocks in this very tight sealed area in good containers. Solar oven, solar dehydrator. Adjacent to this area towards the south should be another area for a solar distiller, a solar oven, and solar dehydrator, and of course the BBQ, barbecue. Okay, in thermodynamics terms, the two driving forces in the universe are simultaneously tendency of less entropy and more entropy. Tending the less entropy is to cool down and dissipate heat. Tending to more entropy is to become radiant and free. Personally, I strive for less tension and more freedom, although sometimes I must compromise one for the other. And that is what water is doing in an evaporator cooler. The quest for freedom on a molecular level is one of the two guiding forces in its physical existence. To gain the greater measure of entropy is the willing to sacrifice a little entropy. Many solar-powered evaporator coolers are on the market now and work really well in arid climates. Here in the South, we have a lot of very high humidity days, so many homes here use heat pumps. Always keep in mind that just by designing a super passive solar dwelling, the active solar systems will use a lot less energy and will mainly serve as backups to top off passive integrated solar systems for added comfort or another desired application. Solar electric cooling and heating sun station. Another good solar cooling application is a solar-powered evaporator cooler. Evaporator cooling is a process phenomena in which evaporation of the liquid typically into surrounding air cools an object or a liquid in contrast with it. Latent heat describes the amount of heat which is needed to evaporate the liquid. This heat comes from the liquid itself and the surrounding gas and surfaces. The greater the difference between the two temperatures, the greater the evaporated cooling effect. When using solar to directly power your evaporator cooler, just use a DC motor for the fan and a DC pump for the means of water circulation. Then install some solar electric PV modules to power the unit either on the roof or on the top of the unit itself. Solar energy and air conditioning are a natural match. The time of day when air conditioning is most needed, of course, corresponds closely to the sunniest times. Thus, it would be nice to use the sun to power air conditioners. And of the various ways devised to use the sun to cool air, PV-made electricity has one big advantage. It can substitute directly as the input power for existing air conditioners, so the AC industry does not have to make any major change to adapt a solar-powered electric unit. Okay, moving right along, here is a very old concept we would like to give a good hard second look. Root cellars are nature's way of storing fruits and vegetables, and they can be excellent storage areas for other things as well. 100 years ago, root cellars were one of the few ways they had of keeping things cool. People not only put potatoes and carrots in their root cellars, but their preserved meats, milk, and cream, fruits and vegetables, literally everything they needed to keep cool. Even though root cellars, storm shelters, didn't get nearly as cold as a modern refrigerator during summer months, root cellars generally were and are 30 to 40 degrees Fahrenheit cooler than daytime summer temperatures. So just by adding a solar cooling device to a root cellar would in effect create a walk-in cooler freezer. Of course, various chambers can be created to have different temperatures ideal for the select foods that are being stored there. As we were researching root cellars, we came across this very interesting concept on the subject. So here is the reference to green home building. Alrighty then. Okay, to the other side of the spectrum, solar heating isn't a problem at all for any solar system. Besides, that is what the sun does best, is heat things up. The subject of solar heating begins again with a good passive solar design. Any good passive solar design would include thermal mass and properly placed and sized glazing, and as always, good insulation. We talked earlier about radiant floors and their advantages. Radiant floors are a good idea, but of course you will need hot water and a pump to circulate it, to move the heat through the tubes to heat the space above the floor. 12-24 volt DC powered circulator pump. This is where the solar hot water collector and the super insulated tank and a photovoltaic pump come into play. But what about those cold, dark days in mid-winter, you may ask? Well, there are several ways to heat water without direct solar power, and these should be installed as backup systems. We are talking about a natural gas hot water heater combination with a wood-burning furnace. During the year, begin to collect firewood. If you are developing a wooded lot, I'm sure this won't be a problem for several years. If you live in an area where firewood is scarce, then natural gas may be your best option as a backup system. If this is the case, I'd advise putting in extra insulation and increased thermal mass to help offset any extra heating cost. If you live in a forest, as I do, hardwoods are everywhere and need thinning out all the time. As well, large limbs break off and fall to the ground after windstorms. Good forest maintenance and selective tree farming will help your forest vibrate and healthy, be vibrant and healthy all throughout your whole lifetime to feed your wood-burning furnaces, hot water heater systems. Thermocouples attached to a wood furnace. The thermocouples begin producing a DC current when the furnace boiler reaches a surface temperature of 250 degrees Fahrenheit. The current is used to maintain a battery charge to operate DC equipment or AC adaptive separate circuits. The furnace is also equipped with water heating thermal siphoning circulator coil that subsidizes two flat plate solar collectors. During the colder seasons, when outside temperature is lowered and use patterns are usually highest, the extra space heating from carefully select hardwoods help to lower demands on other system components. We illustrate this relation superimposed over time with wintertime use patterns. Related patterns based on a typical early spring day at the cabin using solar energy with output temperature averaging 60 degrees. This method will maintain a well-insulated 40-gallon tank at an average temperature of 150 degrees Fahrenheit. What is so eloquent about this system is there is no pumps or the use of electricity to operate the system. The sun's heat drives the solar collector. As hot liquid rises, it is displaced with the colder liquid. The hotter the sun's heat, the faster the liquid travels around the loop. The same is true with the wood furnace. Heat drives the hot water around the system, thus creating the thermal siphon effect. The furnace heats the water directly, whereas a antifreeze solution and a heat exchanger is used for the solar collectors due to the chance of freezing up in the wintertime.